Good morning, everyone. I am Luis Miranda from the Institute of Embedded Systems of the Zurich University of Applied Sciences. And today I'm presenting our insights of the research that we did about precise time synchronization with 10 megabit per second Ethernet. Quick outlook at the agenda. I'll start with an overview about 10 based UNL and precise time synchronization. Then I will talk a bit about Ethernet packet timestamping. Then I will describe the measurement system that we built and the observed effects in the measurements that we did. And I will finalize with some recommendations to achieve better accuracy in time synchronization. So there are two new Ethernet variants with 10 megabit per second speeds. One is 10 base T1S, more aimed towards the automotive industry. It uses a multi-drop topology. And the second one is 10 based UNL, which is what I'm talking today. It's mainly used in the industrial setting and for longer links. So 10 based UNL has a speed of 10 megabit per second. It uses a full duplex mode communication over a single pair Ethernet. And it's used on point-to-point topologies where one of the devices is the master, the other one is the slave, and this link can have up to 1.5 kilometers distance. And it uses 4B3T encoding with PAM3 modulation, and you'll see why this is relevant later on. So 4B3T stands for 4 binary to 3 ternary. It's an encoding type where basically what matters for today is that you encode 4 bits, so a PCS code group into 3 symbols. And in the case of 10 megabit per second, this PCS code group has a period of 400 nanoseconds, and if you then split that to 3 symbols, you get a period of 133 nanoseconds for each symbol. Then precise time synchronization, mainly with GPTP, so IEEE standard 802.1AS. This is a simplification of 1588 for time-sensitive networking, and it aims to achieve a 1 microsecond accuracy between two nodes over a maximum 7 hops. Here I have a short example with 4 devices. And I will give you a brief overview on how it works. So you have the master here on the left, and on the far right you have the slave. The master is the device that has the correct time, and the slave is the one that wants to synchronize its own time to the master. In between you can have different or any devices, and basically how it works is that the master sends a sync message to the next device, and then this gets forwarded until it reaches the slave. This message is timestamped when it's first sent by the master, and this timestamp is inserted inside the message. Then the second device, when forwarding to the next one, also calculates the delay that it took for the message to go from the master to the bridge one in this example, and then also the delay that it took for bridge one to forward it to bridge two. Then every of these delays is included in the sync messages, and they are summed up until it reaches the slave. And then finally, the slave takes the last timestamp here, which is when the sync arrives. And with all these values, it can calculate its phase offset to the master by subtracting T2 and T1 in this example, and the sum of all the delays in between. It's also important to mention that how this link delay is calculated in the protocol. They call it a P-delay mechanism, and basically it measures the mean link delay in between two nodes. So it sends a message from master to bridge one in this case, and then back, and then it averages the time that it took. So this means that if you have any asymmetry on the link, so if one direction takes longer than the other, this is not considered by the algorithm, and it will then introduce an error in the phase offset estimation in the end. So as you can see, there are a lot of timestamping going on, and this is a key point that we have to talk about today. So what's timestamping? Basically, it's saving the time when an event happens. In this case, it's receiving or sending a message. Here on the right, you see more or less a stack where you can see different timestamping planes. The standard defines that the reference plane for the timestamp is the border between the wire and the device. But obviously, you have to timestamp higher up. The important thing here is that the higher you go, the higher the latency is, and as well, the higher the jitter is, and that will make your timestamps have a bigger error. So you should timestamp as close as possible to the wire, ideally inside the PHY, but then you did a special PHY which has a timestamping feature, and for 10BASED-UNL, these are still not available on the market with a standard MAC PHY interface. So the second best place that you can timestamp is actually the MAC PHY interface, and that's precisely what we did in our measurement system. So our measurement system is built in an FPGA. Basically, we connect two PHYs to this FPGA, and we have a frame generator that sends frames periodically through the PHYs. So the frame generator sends to the PHY 1 in this example, that then goes through the twisted cable to PHY 2 and then is received on the other side of the FPGA. In between, we have the latency measurement block, which monitors the MAC PHY interface and looks for the start of frame delimiter, and then it takes the timestamps of sending and receiving. In our system, this happens on both directions since we got a full duplex link, but here it's a simplified image. Our latency measurement block has a 100 MHz clock, which then gives us a 10 nanosecond accuracy in the measurements. Then regarding the PHYs, we bought two different sets of PHYs from two different manufacturers. Both of them have a possibility of using a media independent interface and reduced media independent interface on the MAC PHY. And we also played around with the master slave rules on the measurements, and we used as well different cable lengths. Between the many effects that we saw in the measurements, we decided to categorize them in three main categories, type A, B, and C. Type A errors, they add a fixed offset to each of the timestamps, and this remains constant in any time that the system is up and running. Type B errors, they also add a constant offset while the link is up. This means that if the link is reestablished or the device is reset, this offset might change, and then it makes it harder for you to compensate the value. For type A, you can just measure it once and configure the protocol to consider this value, and then you don't have the issue anymore. But with type B, you cannot simply do it once and leave it. And then finally, we have type C, which adds a random deviation to every timestamp, which in the end will also increase the error in time synchronization. So now the first effect that we saw is related with the timestamp clock granularity. This is a type C error, so it adds a random deviation to each of the timestamps. So regarding timestamp, you always timestamp after the event happens. So this adds an error between zero and the period of the clock, or of the timestamping clock. So this means the faster your timestamping clock is, the less error you'll have in every timestamp, but will always be present regardless of the PHY that you use or which MAC PHY interface you choose. Then the protocol usually, or not usually, it always calculates time intervals, so it subtracts these timestamps. And this means that sometimes the error might compensate itself if you have a similar error between two timestamps. That's the example that I have here with a link delay. So both timestamps of sending and receiving the message have a similar error. So in the end, the measured link delay and the real link delay have the same value despite being shifted in time. Then we did some measurements with the MII, so media independent interface. And this is a type B effect that we noticed because the TX and RX clock were always aligned on the master. And this gives us that on the slave to master latency, we got this steps or staircase appearance on the latency plot when you consider the cable length to the latency. So usually when you do some latency measurements and increase the cable length, as we did here, you always expect that it goes up, because if the cable is longer, it will take more time. And that was the case on the master to slave direction. Then on the slave to master, we saw that we got these steps, and we'll see how this results then in the round trip latency. So if you sum up these two graphs, you end up with a staircase appearance, which means that you have the same latency for different cable lengths. In this case, it's roughly for each 11 meters, you then have a hop for the next stair. And we did this for both PHYs, both behaved similarly in this case. The main difference is that vendor one jumped by 400 nanoseconds. So if you recall, this is the time of a PCS code group, while vendor two just did a jump for 133 nanoseconds. Then there is a second effect still on the MII. It's also type P and is related with the alignment between the PCS code groups and the PAM3 symbols. So if you think again, 400 nanoseconds split by 3, you get 133 nanoseconds, and these are the three possible alignments that you have. So we saw that in one of the vendors, the PHY would present three possible values for latency for the same cable when the link was reestablished. So instead of just one line, you end up with these three. So now if you compare both PHYs from different vendors, you'll end up with these two graphs. Vendor 2 on the left, you have the staircase appearance with 133 nanosecond jumps. And here on the left, you have the PHY from vendor 1, where instead of 133 nanosecond jumps, you have 400 nanoseconds jump. And then you have the second effect superimposed to this. So you have three overlapping stairs here. Then afterwards, we changed the MII to an RMII. So I'll just give you some differences. Mainly, RMII uses fewer connections. Usually that's good, but in this case, it's half. So 8 instead of 16 connections. This makes it cheaper and easier to lay out in the PCB. But this doesn't come for free, so there's a cost associated with it, and this is that the RMI introduces a clock domain crossing, and that's what you see here inside the PHY. And if you're timestamping in the MEC-PHY interface, this means that it will add some uncertainty to your measurement. If you use an MII, you don't have that problem because the clock domain crossing is inside the MEC, so it's after the MEC-PHY interface, so it's after you timestamp. And what does this clock domain crossing do to our timestamping? It introduces a type C effect. So it adds a random error to each of the timestamps. So we call it jitter effect. We saw that on the slave, on the receive side, it added up to 200 nanoseconds jitter, and on the transmit side, 400 nanoseconds. Yeah, this makes already challenging to achieve a 1 microsecond accuracy with the time synchronization protocol. And still, we must not forget that we had the alignment from the PCS code groups to the PAM3 symbols. So this also superimposes in this case, and you'll end up with three bands of 200 nanoseconds on the receiving side that are overlapping. So in total, you have 466.6 nanoseconds jitter on the receiving side, and on the transmitting side, you have three bands of 400 nanoseconds, giving a total of 666 nanoseconds jitter. Yeah, again, this doesn't make things easier on achieving a 1 microsecond accuracy. So to finalize some recommendations, if you need to achieve precise time synchronization, you should use hardware timestamping in the PHY to get the best results. If this is not possible, the MEC-PHY interface is your best bet. Then between an RMII and an MII, the MII introduces less variability and inaccuracies, so you should favor it. Still, there will be some inaccuracies that you can try to improve with some filtering. And as you saw, different PHYs from different manufacturers have different behaviors, so you should choose your PHYs accordingly and measure the latencies. We also observed that often the datasheet didn't have the correct value for the latency. And still, you can expect inaccuracies of hundreds of nanoseconds per hop. But this is only relevant if you are trying to achieve high accuracy time synchronization. Yeah, and that's the end of my presentation. So here I have my contact. If you have any questions, I'm happy to answer them. And yeah, we have downstairs a stand that you can come and see this working as well. Yeah, thank you very much.